subscribe now and press the bell icon. Never miss an update.
Namaste, konnichiwa. Welcome to the Nupur Tiwari Show. Let's talk business. Episode number 7, presented by Heal Tokyo and Heal India. And today, we have our expert with us. And he is the guru of Indian startup. Yes, he knows everything about Indian startup. He has long credential, but I would like to say he's really a guru of Indian startup. And he's none other than Mr. Anil Chikara. So, everyone, as you know, that in Japanese, Chikara means energy, strength, so that thing you can find in him. So with big applause, with business applause, let's welcome Mr. Anil Chikara. Namaste, konnichiwa, Anil. Welcome to the Nupur Tiwari Show. Let's talk business.
Namaste, konnichiwa. It's really wonderful to be talking about a subject that's been very close. I still fondly remember my trip to Japan in, this is way back in 96, 97. And I still remember these were times I went to Japan. And on my, I went to a couple of, this beautiful little gardens that you have there. And bit of temples. And one of the things that always fascinated me was this katana or katakana, what we call them. And I still remember when I tell people now, because I carried it in my hand. And these were times when we were living in very simple times. There was no threats and all that. And I still remember when I went to the counter and every Japanese I met, when they saw this, they were like, oh, you like this? I said, yeah, this, I really love it. And they said, oh, they were so happy about that. And I was carrying it in my hand. I can't even imagine carrying a sword today in my hand. But Nupur, thank you for this opportunity to get reconnected to a country that I really love, both from a technical perspective and from this thing.
Oh, that's so nice of you. Definitely, you know, this is the business between India and Japan, not much explored. We have done a lot of things with West European countries. But when it comes to Japan, Eastern countries, and especially Japan, Japan is so rich when it comes to business, everything, culturally, everything. Everything can be business, you know, tourism can be business. Anything can be, even culture, through culture, you can generate business. And what you are in, there are a lot of startup in technology related startup in India, and this is so rich in technology, but we never explored that connection. What do you think, Anil?
I think it is sad because you know, and I think there are multiple reasons for that. One is that, you know, because of the US influence on the world, we kind of always looked west when it came to whether it's education or whether it's, you know, tourism or things like that. And another factor could be from a Japan perspective is that the language thing, where, you know, a lot of Indians who travel outside, they are very comfortable with English. But I still remember when I went to Japan, there were some people who could not talk in that. And maybe that could have been, a, you know, kind of a barrier to do that. But if we really look at the past, and I'm not saying the past 100 years, let's talk about the past 1,000 years. You know, both from religion, whether it's Buddhism, whether it's cultural values, whether it's family values, whether it's that honor, whether it's the family name, or things like that. All of them, if you look at that, we find a lot of parallels to that. And somewhere along, I think India went through in the last 200 years because of the British and all that. And, you know, we kind of, even in India, we kind of lost touch with our own culture and started thinking that maybe English is the thing that we need to kind of focus on. But lately I felt that, you know, there is no reason why the next century does not belong to Asia. And I think this move started a couple of years back, where you could see perceptibly that, you know, India started developing much closer relations with the countries in the East. And I would go as far as, you know, Australia. That has also improved a lot. And especially, I think, when the present government came, the Modi government came, I think there was seen a much more closeness between Japan and India. And not just the aim, but even whatever leader comes, one is kind of constant, is that attachment that is there between Japan and India. I think now time has come. See, another thing I feel, and maybe you know better, I'm no expert in Japan, but I think there are a lot of good technologies, good startups, but Japanese startups are more kind of inward focused. You know, they're happy serving the local market and things like that. I think now time has come where we need to look beyond that and explore the big opportunity. Because if you look at India, you know, beyond China, India is the largest single market today, you know, which is developing. The kind of potential that it has, the way we feel it will develop in the next 50 to 100 years, you know, and it's a great opportunity for Japan, because Japan has, see, what I really love about Japan is that Japan has been able to maintain that balance between culture, family values, traditions, religion, and the best latest technologies, which I have not seen in the West. In the West, typically when they go technology side, the families start falling apart and, you know, things like that. Whereas in Japan, I see this huge thing. And recent times, I see this connection to culture and our traditions against waning strength in India, and especially among the new generation. So I think that this is the right time for India to, as I said, look east rather than look west.
This is a very wonderful line you have said, that look east rather than looking at west.
Yes.
Yeah, wow, this is going to be our slogan then, maybe. Somebody is going to steal it. Before somebody steals it, you can just trademark it, yes. Anil. So, yes, you are right. But as I was talking to on the other day, one Japanese company's CEO, and he was saying that we definitely, you know, they're withdrawing their businesses from China and their eyes are on India. They want to invest in India. But the problem is, Anil, that there is somewhere like Japanese, that if I say Japanese way, they're like, you know, it's like, should I go or no? Because, you know, that trust that they do respect us, definitely. There are a lot of respect. But like Indian, we without studying, we go for exam, kind of. Which Japanese would say that is like, they before exam, they will just keep studying. I'm just giving a small example. Like their preparations are much harder. Then us, we are more into jugaad. I wouldn't say like everyone, like they feel that way for our, when it comes to Indian, they like Indian means we just, everything we say yes, but we don't deliver. This is the way they put it, you know. So what do you think, things are changed, or things going to be really better, or what they are thinking, they're wrong? Which one do you think?
See, multiple things. One, you said, maybe you said it in jest, but like, for example, for studies and all that. And I'm happy people are not taking exams seriously in India, you know, because
that frankly, was just an
whatever you study today will be irrelevant in the next 10 years. So, see, I have worked with American companies. I have worked with, partnered with European companies, and I have partnered with the Japanese company. One fundamental difference that I saw between American companies and this is the initial decision making in American companies is very fast. Whereas Japanese, they take time. And frankly, it was the first time we were doing a deal in Japan, it was slightly frustrating that if we have sorted out everything, why do you want to keep going over it again and again? And but once they finalized and something went wrong in a project, you know, the whole attitude of the Japanese team partners was that we studied everything, we went through it with our eyes open, we did not hurry into it. Now, whatever happens, we are in it together. So we are in it for the long haul. I think that is the difference between, so America is, okay, awesome, let's go. And the moment something happens, you're fired. Whereas in Japan, I think the thing is that let's take time to get into a relationship. You know, the courtship is very important. And once we are in it, both the sides are responsible for making it successful, rather than, you know, say American company, oh, you screwed up, I don't care, it's your problem. Japanese will say, no, it's our this thing. So I think, see, every country has its culture. And the pace at which India is moving today is very, very fast. You know, look at the unicorns coming up, startups coming up, tech coming up, how new, like renewable energy coming up or electric vehicles coming up and all that. The pace is fast. And India is a chaotic country. We all know that. So when you go in there, it hits you. But there is a certain method in that madness, you know, what I say. As I say, the force be with you. There is a certain force in India which kind of works with that. And, you know, we are, what, 1.3 billion people. So even if you find 5% really smart guys, that is 70 million people. What's the population of Japan?
126 million.
So look at India. We are 1.3 billion people, right? So even if we take, say, 10% of that, that's 130 million. Japan's population, as you know, is about what, 125 to 130 million, right? Now, it's wrong to say, generalize about India. Because, I meet people who are in the IT space, and when they meet, their perception is everybody in India is a software developer. You know, but we have hardly 5% of that. So what I'm saying is that rather than generalizing, you need to reach out to the proper communities. And today with the digital world, there are different communities. There's community who's very prompt about things. There are communities who are very passionate about things. There are communities which are very passionate about social causes. So I think what you need to do is find that community rather than generalizing based on the people that you, the tourists that you meet, or that guy who migrated to Japan and set up a restaurant, Indian restaurant or something like that. So I wouldn't say that everybody is like that.
Very, very rightly you said, and I expected that answer from you, because I know that you are an expert. Yes, very rightly you said that they have to go to the right people. They have to approach to the right people to get the right result. Definitely. Yeah, they cannot
another
just...
Another thing is also, it is like, do not expect things to work in India the way they work in Japan. Mm-hmm. Because, see, this is like you go and try out some new food in a new country. But if you keep comparing that food with your own food, then you will always get disappointed. Like, I remember first time I went to US, whatever food I ate, I was like, no, this is not spicy. This is doesn't have those garam masala or, you know, whatever we eat in India. And I was always disappointed. But now when I go there, I say, this is different and this is different. Each of them has to be looked at its own individuality. So I would say, you know, when people come to India, they have a binary relationship. Either they hate it or they love it. There's nothing in between. That's the thing about India, right? And depending on where you go, you will find things which are totally different. The environment, the way people behave, the way people dress, the way people show off. North is totally different, West is totally different, South is totally... Bangalore has about 70% of population which is not local. And I think 10 or 20% of them are not Indian. So you see the eclectic mix of people. And I think amazing things are happening in India. The numbers are crazy. You talk about launching a thing and you say, can I get 10 million users on that in the next 1 year? Yeah, why not?
So, for Japanese viewers, I would like to say, これはインドは違うですよ。インドの北インド、南インド、東インド、西インド全部違うだから、インドはこれとか言わないでください。インドのいろんな、いろんなところ行ったらいろんな経験があります。そんなこと言ってますと思います。そんなこと言っています。So I just said that, yeah, what you already explained that India is very different and it's a like cosmic mess. It's a cosmic mess. I think it's a...And it's a beautiful thing. Cosmic mess means you can find your spirituality there.
Yes.
And yes. Every part of India is very different. Everything from your attire to food to culture. It's like so many countries in one country. Yeah. And this is the beauty of India, definitely. So when actually now, since so many years, you are with startup, you are...guiding, you have guided and you are guiding so many people, so many startups. So startup, what exactly they expect from Japan?
See, I think any startup, when they go out, you know, when they go to any other country, there are just a couple of things they're looking for. Either they're looking for technologies out there, which they can take that technology and use it in their solution and create value in the local market.That is one thing. Or vice versa, where they have something which they feel can add value to the other country and do that. But, you know, in the last 1 year, very interesting thing is happening. See, work from home became a norm. And before that, the gig economy was growing very fast and people... Well, I get my graphics work done from a guy in Sri Lanka.I get my startup logo and brochures and all done from a guy in Bosnia, you know. So people were already, you know, connected and they were working from wherever they are. The last 1 year, what has happened was this work from home culture became very strong. And in the last 3 months, I have seen there's a new culture coming up, startup from home, where they're saying sitting in your home, you can find your co-founder.Who could be anywhere in the world. So, for example, I'm doing something which applies to the Japanese market and Indian market. And the solution means that I have to get some tech from Japan and the sales will happen in India, for example. Then if I'm setting up, I would find a co-founder in Japan who would be the CTO and work there. And me or whoever else can be the co-founder here. So now you have an opportunity to create startups with even the founders being multi-country. You know, the best thing about the startup ecosystem is that the startup world is like a digital country. You know, today you go to any country and you go and ask, hey,which is the nearest co-working place, for example. Or you go on Google Maps and say co-working place or startup incubator or accelerator or university startup or something. And the moment you walk into that place and say, hey, you know what? I'm a startup from Bangalore. And in 10 minutes, everybody will be their friend. Because the startup country, which is a digital country, which has nothing to do with the physical borders, is a country of citizens who are entrepreneurs and who want to make a better world. You know, they want to do something, they see something in this world, they don't like it and they want to change it. You know, so that is true, whether you are from Africa, Europe, Japan, Australia, those traits are same.Traditional businesses may change. So trading, the way trading happens in Japan may be very different from the way trading happens in this. Or the way manufacturing happens in Japan may be very different. But the way startups happen, the way VCs come in, the way angel investors put in money, the way then VC funds come in and the way it gets acquired. Today, it's a global thing. You know?
Right. But
that is the best thing that I have seen happening in the whole startup ecosystem, where it's not just my customers are outside or this side or that. Even the teams and even the founding teams can be global. And I
would,
that's a great opportunity I see between Japan and this, because see, a philosophy of a company, the DNA of a company is defined by the founders. What values they carry, what do they feel passionately about? And if it's a startup where we feel that, you know, the Japanese technology or way of working is going to be a big USP for us, and one of the founder, the CTO or chief operating officer or the CEO is from Japan, the other founder is from India, maybe third is from US and all that, I think we can create a unique global culture within that company where we take the best from Japan, best from India. See, India, people say Jugaad, and people feel that there's something wrong in that. I call it Google innovation. Matlab, India could send a Chandrayaan to Mars, and you know the per kilometer running cost was lower than a Bajaj auto. So, which US could never think of. And now all these countries who have aspirations are coming to India to launch their satellites and all that. You know, so I think there's a lot to be learned from India, frugal innovation, make do with whatever you have. And on the other side, the perfection, attention to detail, you know, the long-term planning. I think what Indians lack is the planning. They would rather jump and do it and learn on the go. It's like I jump from the cliff and I keep building a parachute as I'm falling down. Whereas the Japanese will say, let me build the parachute, test it, and then I will jump it, you know. Combination there waiting to be, you know.
Totally. Totally, yeah. I think this is too good. I think we have best side, they have best side. So two exactly. Best sides, we have to just mix it and we can become really the best in the world. Yeah. As I always say, the Indian spirituality and Japanese productivity, if we can just mix both things, and we will become really more productive and the best in the world. So yeah, I hope that this is really the Japanese viewers who are watching, they get really inspired and they go more. They start investing more and more in India, and Indian startup also start getting more Japanese funds. And the both countries, both beautiful countries, not only culture wise, but the more closer we can bring India and Japan business wise as well.
See, and so, I think in the last 12 months, the whole world has flipped. You know, earlier when we said, oh, India, suppose I'm sitting in Japan, I'm like, India, which are the startups? I have to go there, I have to meet, and I have to, you know, travel. Maybe I'll have a stomach upset and, you know, that pollution and, you know, everything, right? And now everything's happening virtually. So if somebody wants to get to start understanding the ecosystem of both sides, all it takes is maybe one organization on that side. Like I run this Blue Bolt Startup Factory, which is a deep tech startup accelerator. A similar organization there, we say, okay, every fortnight, we will pick up some startups from here, which will just present. You know, and you pick up some startups that will present, and then let them talk. Let's see where it goes. So without even going out of your home, you can start that collaboration.
You know? Great. Wonderful. Yeah, this is really great. Maybe we can do something like that. Again, another great startup show. Startup show we can start. So, yeah, it's always, always a pleasure talking to you, Anil. And I'm sure the viewers there, they're getting enlightened, and not only Indian viewers, but definitely the Japanese viewers also, they are getting to know a lot of things through you, the way you explain things. And this is just our beginning, because you are an expert and people would love to learn from you a lot more things. So I would love to have you again and again. So sure. Thank you
no,
so
I think
much.
Time has come. I think the next century belongs to East, and I think India and Japan can play a very pivotal role in the next 100 years. I'm looking at long term here, not the next 10, 15 years.
So now you are Japanese, you're talking like Japanese, the next century.
see, I don't know if what I say may be controversial, but when you are, what this lockdown and COVID has shown us that, you know, you need to take a long term view of what you're doing, and especially when your adversary China is looking at that kind of a scale, you can't be looking till the next election and say, okay, we will see what happens in the next 4 years and then we will see what will happen. I think time has come for India to take a long term view and say, you know, at one time India constituted 25% of GDP of the world, and today it's not even 5% or 2%. So I think time has come where we can reclaim that past, you know, position.
Yes, of course, we always can, and we are here. Definitely, we are dedicated to our country, so we yes. will be working on that. And as I said, the viewers and all the startup guys, Japan and India, they would love to be enlightened by you, and maybe you will be coming up with some startup soon someday. Sure. You never know. Sure. So thank you so much. Thank you so much.
My for pleasure. Giving
time. And thank you, and looking forward to having you again.
My pleasure.
Thank you, and namaste.
So everyone, that was our episode number 7, Let's Talk Business with Mr. Chikara, and I'm sure that you have learned a lot of things. Yes, we do promote your business, we do tell your startup stories. So if you need to tell your startup stories to the world, do contact us. I'll see you next Friday. Until then, do take care of yourself and do love yourself too. Everyone, we have another 2 shows as well. On Saturday, Nupurte Wari Show, and Sunday, Shakti Women Who Fought Odds. So we have 3 shows. So I'll see you tomorrow as well. But for business show, I'll see you next Friday. Until then, do take care. Subratri, good night. Vyasminasai. Namaste.
Subscribe now and press the bell icon. Never miss an update.